Boards and booze and boards, drink some beers, fight some hordes, drank too much, forgot our swords, ran back home, filled our gourds, got drunk again, sang some chords, boards and booze and boards, with Mickey and Jeb.
You know, Mickey, I woke up today and I was like, what would it have been like if I was back when civilization started and I had to go hunting and gathering stuff and building? So, if only there was a way that I could realize what that was like. Mickey, I think you've already devolved into that state. Stone Age!
That was our idiocy for this morning, people. Yep.
So, we're playing Stone Age today. Hi, everyone. Booze and Boards, Mickey and Jeb. We're busting out this worker placement that is what, like a pretty basic one, I guess. I don't want to say.
It's pretty straightforward, yeah. in terms of worker placement. The theme's kind of is kind of cool. It's I'll say consider it a little bit of a modern day classic. A lot of people have heard of it. Mm-hmm. So we're not busting out a brand new one here, but we like to have some of the ones that you might get recommended if you're just starting out in the hobby.
And I think it actually just got reprinted.
It did, right. And, we like to have those things available to new players. Or maybe you've been gaming a while and you haven't heard of it yet. And not that you couldn't read the rules yourself, but
right.
What we're going to do is we're...
It's a lot easier to watch people show you everything,
It is, so that's what we're going to do. We're going to go over this relatively modern day classic, I'll call it. I don't know if that's the best word for it, but let's see. Is it Z-Man Games?
Yep, and 2 to 4 players, 13 plus, and 60 minutes to 90 minutes is what it says.
Yep, so a relatively average time, I would say, not short, not long, and yep. Who's the designer again?
Brunhofer.
Brunhofer, so.
If that's how you pronounce it.
Yeah, so.
We're really bad at pronunciations. I believe people have corrected us on some of the things we say.
Yep, we try.
Yep.
Try to give you credit. We might not do a good job, but, you can get the box and look at it and try to pronounce yourself.
Yep. So, I guess we'll go into our setup and how to play, and if you already know how to play, then you should just skip ahead to the next part where we actually play a game of it and see how bad I play this game. All right, we'll be back. And we are back with components. So we've got, as you can see, the game board, right?
Yep, game board for Stone Age. It is worker placement, so hopefully you can see there's like little places to put meeples and things like that, some cards, buildings. We'll get into all that during setup. That's pretty straightforward board.
And there's all the components to the game.
Woohoo!
One thing is every player has a player board.
Right here. And the player board has, different sections for cards and basically cards, tools, and your people and resources and stuff.
Next up are the resources, like Mickey just said.
All right. So for resources, remember, you have stone, which are the gray ones. You have the bricks, which are the red. You have gold, which are the yellow. And you have wood, which are the brown log-looking things. These are resources.
Next up are the figures or meeples that the players will get.
These are your... you have the four kind of basic colors. You have... each player has 6, 10. You have 10 meeples and 2 cubes. One cube is basically for your to go around the victory track, and the other cube will go on the your production or your harvest track, and that tells you how much food you produce per turn.
Then there are the food tokens.
Food tokens are right here. They all have different little pictures on it. The ones have berries, the fives have fish, the twos have mushrooms, and I have no idea what 10 is supposed to be. Maybe a pile of hay or something. Regardless, the pictures mean nothing. They're just flavor, and it's kind of cool, but all of these are food tokens.
All right, then we have the building tiles.
Okay, your building tiles are these tiles here, and they just have... there's a victory point up in the corner, and there's a cost down in here to purchase. The buildings will get into more of these in a little bit, because some of them do have, like, the victory points is based on whatever it says down here, and we'll explain more of that in a bit.
Then there are tool tiles.
Okay, your tool tiles are... They all look the same. They have different numbers, but they have a Stone Age type looking hatchet on it. And so you have a 1 with a 2 on the other side, and you also have a stack of 3s with a 4 in the other side. Okay.
There is a first player token that comes with the game.
And it's like basically a king. He's right here, you can see it. It probably needs some glue because you can't really pick him up without the bases coming out. I wouldn't say it's super necessary in this game. It's not like, I mean, turn order just goes around the table, so...
You don't even need him to stand up, you just...
Yeah, you could just slide him around, too.
Yeah. Then there are the civilization cards.
Civilization cards? Is your deck of cards here. They have various components to them, like there's a victory point, and like that would be number of workers, blah blah blah. This one costs food, but it has a symbol on the bottom. We'll get to those, but there's tons of various cards, so we'll go over that in a bit.
And finally, there are the dice and the dice cup.
And the dice are right there, as you can see.
They're just D6s, right?
Yeah, they're just D6s. They're wooden, so that kind of goes with the feel of the game. And then a nifty little leather cup, which I think is kind of cool. You know, you don't have to use it, obviously. You can just pick up and roll the dice. But it's neat, because the game is Stone Age, and yeah. You have, like, the wooden dice and the leather cup. It adds to the feel of the game. So, you know, they're all solid. Good board. All the pieces are pretty, pretty good. They're all wooden and all that type of stuff, so it's nice.
And then the only other thing is the rule book and a summary sheet that comes with the game.
Get a rule book, and you get a summary sheet, because, like I was pointing out to you, some of the cards and the buildings and stuff have different effects. They're all right there, and they're pretty easy to understand.
I think that is everything for components, so we will get into how to set up the game. Alright, we are back with the setup for Stone Age. So we'll just run through how to set everything up, like we normally do. So the first thing is to place the board, which, as you can see, is easily done. You set it on the table. the next thing is to sort the food tokens accordingly to value and stack them on the hunting grounds.
The art's really kind of cool in this, and this is the hunting ground area over here. You'll notice that the supply ones have a big picture of whatever supply they're doing. But this is hunting ground, and you can see that the hunters are out there, and then there's like a bear here, and it looks like there's, I don't know what they are, but there's animals and stuff. And there's even a guy over here picking berries to go along with the berry ones. But so you just stack these over here. Any way you want. You know, probably a numerical order is what most people have some sort of system. But there you go.
After that, you will put the wood resources on the forest.
And again, like they... There's a giant picture of a wood resource, and you just literally take them all and put them on the board.
And then after you put the wood in the forest, you put the clay in the clay mounds, or on the clay mound.
That's the one that looks like the bricks. There's your clay mound.
And after that, you put gold, or nope, sorry, stone on the quarry.
And there's the quarry, and there's the stone.
And after the stone is the gold on the river.
And the gold is in the water.
All right,
next. Yeah, look at that. They actually, when they pan for gold, they get a whole, like, brick of gold. That's amazing.
If only it was that easy back in those days, right? Next up are the tool tiles assorted by value. So you'll put the ones, and the twos are on the back, so you'll...
Yep, and they stack. So basically, the lowest number is what goes face up. So you have the ones and the threes.
Then after that, civilization cards are shuffled and set next to the board.
So that's all the cards here. And they just get... And you just set them right off to the side.
And it says, starting with the rightmost space, reveal four cards.
Trying to sit on Jeb's side of the table.
And the only reason we have the deck up here is because we have a player board set up, but you can just put it there. It doesn't really matter. Next, you will put the building tiles are shuffled and stacked in piles of seven.
So the building tiles are, they are one-sided. That's what the blind side looks like. And then, so you shuffle them up. Jeb's going to shuffle the rest of them. And then you literally do piles of seven. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven.
I've got a six right here.
That's a seven. And you do, this is a six right there, then that should leave me with just enough seven, because the game does scale if you have less than four people.
Yeah, it says that it depends on the number of piles is equal to the number of players. So if you play a two-player game, you would only have two piles.
And they would, and then whatever is not used goes back in the box.
Yep. And then after you place those piles down, you reveal the first tile of each stack.
I can't reach Jim.
I guess I have to work, huh? And then after that, players will choose their colors and place a small marker on the zero of the agriculture track and the big marker on the scoring track.
Okay, so this is the agriculture track, the one with the picture of the wheat up at the very top. Everybody puts their small cube at zero and their big cube up there. What Jeb can be green today. So if Jeb was playing, that's what that would look with another player. And obviously the rest will be out there when I think we are playing a four-player game today, so you'll get to see everything in action.
All right. Next up, the players are going to take a player board and put five figures of their color and 12 food.
Okay. So. All right, slide. Here comes the player board. All right, so we'll say that it's me, and I always like to be blue because that's my favorite color, and I like to stand my people up so they're ready to go.
My guys are going to be, like, laying around drunk, exactly. Passed out.
And then you probably want to have something so you can make change. So there's five, there's nine. 10, 11, 12. So that's what you start with.
All right, and then you will put the 12, or you will put the remaining figures, five of them is how many should be left, and you make a supply.
So just off to the side, these are not for use yet.
Yeah, so I know some people had mentioned that they just kind of put all the colors in one big supply on the side so people can't, like, accidentally grab them. But it depends on...
I don't know. It seems to me as long as it's not... If the player board is a decent size. I feel like that as long as you remember to put the stuff on your board, that you're not going to get confused because you can earn the other ones later. But that's a personal preference. I understand what Jeb's... The point of wherever he read that comment would be if they're all mixed up, then your brain will instantly say... That's the supply.
Yeah. And then the final, you put the dice in the dice cup
nearby, so people are going to be using that.
Oh, yay. Wee! Dice cup.
And then finally, the youngest player goes first, is what it says. So I guess you would give them the first
player. Oh, no cutesy stuff. Not anything like, whoever looks like a Neanderthal Jeb will go first.
I don't have any
no respect.
I'm so used to being called like Bigfoot and stuff that I was like, oh, okay.
I was going to get a club and beat Jeb over the head at the intro, but I couldn't find one.
It's great being Jeb, huh? All right, so that's everything for setup. So we will start, or we will come back with how to play the game, I guess is the important part, right?
Yep.
We will explain how to play Stone Age, and I'm going to say a quick overview of how the gameplay works. It's pretty much you place your figures, you collect your resources, and you feed your tribe. So that's like a summary of a game round, and it's played over a number of rounds.
The end game condition?
End game is not enough civilization cards to fill the four spaces on the bottom of the table.
Because these will get refreshed every time.
Yep, and then the other is one building pile is empty. And then there are conditions that if it's the end condition with the four slots that can't be filled, it's an immediate game end. But if it is the building pile,
the round finishes.
Yep. So,
because this happens, it's one of the last things that happens, so if you can't fill it, then that means if that's an end game, there wasn't anything left in the round. So.
Right.
But they just clarify that because they don't want you going like, oh, should I just do one more? No, you shouldn't.
Okay, so let's start talking about the game rounds. So the first thing of the game round is one after another, players are going to place their figures on the board.
Okay, so a quick overview of what that means on the board. Okay, so the board has multiple sections. So you have the hunting grounds, the forest, the clay field mine, it's not a mine,
mound.
Whatever. The clay mound, the quarry, the riverbank for the gold, I forget what they call that part, and a hut. And this is called the field spot. Okay, so, real quick, when it's your turn to place figures, you can put as many figures as you want, barring there's these little circles, okay? So there's little circles to put your meeples.
Yeah, so you pick one location, and right. You can put as many as you want.
And you can put as many as you want. The hunting ground is basically unlimited. Okay,
there's no circle.
Right, there's not individual circles. The forest has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 spots. The clay mound has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Oh, it looks like they all have 7. Okay, I didn't know that. Just first time. However, the field has just 1 spot. The hut has just 2 spots, which must be used by the same person. Yes, these two are going to go into the hut and, and then,
making babies.
There's one more spot I didn't point out in just a second ago, which is the, has to do with the tools, and it's literally called the tool maker spot. And this one is also, because it's right by the tools, 1 spot. So, if you're paying attention, great. If somebody lands on the spot that I wanted to do this turn, you're out of luck because you can't kick that person off. However, the first player marker does move, so eventually, if you really, really need to do that, you will get be able to do that. So, for instance, if it was my turn, I could pick a spot, and I will take Nina into the hut. And then if it was Jeb's turn, Jeb, what would you
I'm
like
gonna
to
go
do?
Off to the forest alone.
Just one, a single person
yeah,
in the forest?
Why not?
Jeb's not very bright in the way the mechanics work in this game.
It's not like we're playing right now.
Okay.
Alright, and then Jeb, next...
Look, another one of Jeb's guys wandered into
friend.
The forest.
Alright.
And then it's just us two right now, so then I would be like, oh, there's still a few spots. I could probably use some of that, too. And then, Jeff,
Here's a quick thing. I have meeples left. I am not allowed to pass. So I couldn't say I'm not placing anything and then Mickey goes again. If I have meeples, I have to place them when it comes around to me.
As long as you're able to do so, which there's really...
It's infinite over at the food, so you'll be able to place...
And, like, all the cards literally do have a place to put something, and you don't actually have to do the action if you can't or you don't want to, so...
And then another thing is you cannot place meeples on a place you've already placed them.
Right.
So right now it's my turn. I could not put... two more people on the woods because I've already chose the woods.
Like, so if you go back and go,
I
made a mistake or whatever, or I could really use that, or somebody took my spot, too bad. You can't go back into where you've already been. Jeb, where do you want to put?
I'll put one person on the tool shed.
Just one on the tool shed, okay. I have one left and I will, I'm going to go for... That's not a good... I don't have any resources yet. But I'm going to do that and we'll make pretend anyways.
And then I'll put one on the one resource card. And I have one more spot. Are you filled up?
What?
You've got five on the board, I've got four. So I'll put one on the field, I guess. That's a different one. The hut field or whatever.
Oh, yeah. Sorry. You said field. You didn't say hunting ground.
Oh.
Okay, so we've both placed all our meeples. Obviously, you can see if there's more people in the game, things can fill up faster, blah, blah, blah. But at this point...
Just a quick run through. When you place, you pick one spot and you can place... one to however many you want, depending on the limitation. Certain places have limits. You cannot pass if you have figures left. You cannot place a figure on a location that already has yours, which we mentioned. And then there are ones that have certain limitations, like the hut that Mickey has two of the same. It has to be two of the same people.
Right. The field is only one. The building, the tool maker is only one. And the resource ones are limited to 7 each,
yep.
And the hunting ground is wide open.
And the buildings are one.
And the, everything,
yeah,
that, at least one. All the stuff that's showing, I don't remember if there's any, like, super good ones that cost 2 or something.
Yeah, so that's everything for placement. So we just go around like we just did with all the players and we place. So the next thing is the players are going to take the actions associated to their figures. So starting with the first player... it goes around clockwise. So Mickey is the first player in this case.
Now, I can do the actions in any order I want, but I do all my actions. And why that may be important is because for some of the buildings and the civilization cards, you might actually need a resource to pay for them. So I might be like, well, I want to try to get my wood or my clay or my stone before I resolve these cards because... I need that resource first or I'm not going to be able to buy it. So it's important to note that you don't have to remember how you placed anything. You just do your actions. So, and we'll go around the board and describe each spot even if we don't have anything on it. But I'll start with mine and I'll start with the hut. So if you put two people on the hut, you take these people out and you had a baby. So you get a new person to put into your supply. So obviously you won't get to use him this turn because you just got it. You put it back on your player card and that's how you resolve the hut.
I will resolve the toolmaker.
Okay, so Jeb takes his figure back, puts it on his card, and he takes a tool card and he places that in the slot on his player card. Can you see that, Joe? You want to slide over for a second?
Yeah, they can
see
that.
They can see that?
I know it's Mickey's player board, but he's just showing off where
it is. So it goes right here on your player card, and every time you do that, you will put a new one, and we're going to show you because this is how it works, all on one until it's at 3. At that point, if you take another tool maker action, you would flip this one to 2.
If you take it again.
And you flip the next one to two.
And again. And
it will go the next one to two. Aha! Now what if I do it again, Mickey and Jeb? Then you get to put this one back and take a three.
And I think you guys understand how
it And it goes one more time to four, and then after that you can't upgrade anymore. That's how the tool maker works. Yep. And I'll leave one on because Jeb bought that for me as a present.
Oh, boy. Okay, so Mickey, you can choose what you want to do next.
Okay, so this, what I'm going to do next is the forest. And this is basically how all of the food and resource gathering works in the game. So I look at the wood spot and I say I have two meeples. So I take two meeples and I can put them back, and then however many meeples I had, I take that number of die and I roll them. Okay?
A three and a one.
A three and a one. I add the result together.
That's a four.
A four. I look at the card, your player card, and you'll notice that on the player card, each resource and food has a value underneath. That's how it does two things. That's how you determine how much you'll get, and it also, if it provides victory points, it's how you figure out how much it's worth in victory points. However, I'm in the forest, I rolled a four, it's a three, so I take four, I divide it by three, rounded down, that's how many pieces of wood I get. So, guess what? I only get one piece of wood. However, you can modify dice rolls with your tools. Here's how that works. So, I have a four right now, and let's just pretend that I have three tools already purchased. I really needed another piece of wood. To get to that, I would have needed six. I can basically use the tools, two tools, and add these ones to my roll. And now I have six. And I
six
can get
divided by the three is two.
Is two, and I would have two, and I still have a tool to use later on in the game. The tools can be used for anything that, not anything, they can be used to modify the dice roll in pretty much anything, okay?
And you turn them to the side to indicate
that,
that
you've already used them, yes.
And then after your turn's over, they reset, I believe.
And there's not a limit if you, like, you know, so if I had upgraded this one, if this had been a two, I would only have to do that, and then I would have had the six. So you can really manipulate how you have, and if you're starting to get it all together, so the more people you have in a place, the better odds you're going to get the resource that you wanted. However, it gets harder to get the resources, because if you've noticed on the card, when Jeb had it slid over here, I think you can still see it.
Yep.
So this one, the food is a divide by two, the wood is a divide by three, the four, the clay is a divide by four, the stone is a divide by five, and of course our most expensive precious metal is divide by six. So it's hard to get the gold. Anyways.
So when does those actually reset, the tools?
At the end of the round.
At the end of the round. Okay, sorry. I think I said end of the turn. It's end of the round that they reset. Alright.
So I would take... I'll pretend I didn't even have any tools. So I don't get one piece of wood. I just put it on my card, and then now I have it for future events.
All right. So, and as Mickey said, that works the exact same way with the food, the clay, the stone, the gold, and the wood.
And remember, if you can't remember what to divide by, just look at your card. It's right there. Your player card has all that information.
So I'll do mine really quick because I'm on the forest. Look at
oh
that.
Oh my gosh.
So I got 12, and I have a tool, but I don't think I need
me,
to use
no,
it.
Not for that. So he gets four.
Yep.
So yeah. Jeb would take these four and probably give them to me, because another present.
All right. So, Mickey, you want to activate your guy?
All right. So on the building cards, I activate my person. I put it back on my card just like every other time. I literally take the building, and I look up at the top, And up in the top left corner is straight up how many victory points you get. However, some of the all the building cards have some kind of cost down here.
So just a quick easy one. This has a 16 victory point, and the cost is 2 stone and a gold.
Right. So you pay the cost, and I picked this one just because I wanted to go over one of the special ones with you guys. The ones with the normal symbols are literally what, like Jeb just said, you pay that, you put it on your card, and you move up the victory track. That's literally all you do. Okay? Let's take a look at this one, though. So this has a 5, and it has a multicolored...
whatever symbol that is.
Multicolored thing. So basically what that means is it can use any resource. Remember, a resource is gold, stone, clay, or wood, not food. Food is not a resource. And then it has in parentheses a 2 of those, right? So these in parentheses mean they have to be unique. So this means 5 resources of 2 unique kinds, all right? So I could use 1 piece of wood and 3 gold. I could use 2 stones and 3 bricks. I could use 3 stones, 2 wood. You get the picture. So how do you calculate that? Again, you go to your card. You look how much each of those items that you paid for the card are worth. And then that's your number of victory points. So, for instance, if I used 3 wood and 2 clay for that, well, 3 wood is 3 times 9. So that's, 3 times 3 is 9.
Yep.
And then the clay is 4, so 2 times 4 is 8. So I would get 17 victory points if I purchase this card. You put it on, you go up the track, you put it on the card. That's it. That's exactly how it works. And you flip the new one over. You don't have to wait for end of round to flip stuff over. There's a place for 5 buildings on your card. Once you fill those up, you just start stacking the new ones. It's not a limit.
Okay. I will activate my guy on the card. So for that one, the cost is up here. So it's just 1 resource, not food, any resource. So I have a wood, so I can pay a wood to get it. And then you resolve the card,
and all these cards are different, but in this case, this has a big picture of a resource on it, so Jeb would immediately get 1 gold. On the bottom of all the cards, there's end game victory conditions. We're not going to go into what every single one of them does, but this, however, is a multiplier. This is a shaman, and that is a meeple, so it's shaman times number of people in your village during end game scoring. But just, it's important to remember that the bottom parts are just end game things.
So, and that's all in the rule book and cheat sheet.
So he would get this. He just takes the card and...
I get the resource at the top, and then I take the card and put it face down.
Right, and I don't know if you can see this, but it's basically, there's the spot for those. However, there are a few cards in the thing that let you use like a tool or something like that for an immediate use or a later use.
Yeah, that one.
And you can just set those to the side until you decide to use it, and then you can put it in the pile to show that it's been used. This is where you collect all your cards, and as you can see, this is a chart to calculate your things. These are set collectors down here. There's a nice little chart that shows you how many points you'll get for each unique thing in a set. And on the side here, it tells you exactly what the multipliers are for each different ones of these. So there's a lot of victory points that can be gained through these cards. And again, this is just a place to save them all.
Okay. And then notice that after I went, we do not refill that spot. That happens later. I will activate my last guy.
Right. And which is another unique spot. So Jeb takes his figure off the field, back on his card, and he moves his production one up one space. And so now he is on a 1.
And I think we've covered all the spots on the board,
yep,
right?
Yep, because all the these top ones work the same with the divisors. And the unique one you saw, the field, moves this track up once. The hut is where you get more people. And the tools is where you upgrade your ability to modify your dice. And then these are just, they just do various things. They give you stuff, et cetera, et cetera.
Yep. All right. So that's everything for taking the actions. You just, like I said, it's
keep going around until
player,
everybody's done.
Until it's all gone, or all the meeples are gone. So the last thing the players do is feed their tribe. So the important thing to know is that each figure needs one food. So however many meeples you have, you need a food for each of them.
Right.
So in this phase, what you do is you get one food for each step on the agricultural track that you're at.
So I get a big fat zero, and
I get one.
And Jeb gets a one. And so he would just take a one, and you put that in his supply. And once you've done that,
you have
feed him.
Yep, pay one food per meeple on the board. Leftover food is kept.
Right. So that's why you get a supply at the food beginning. They don't make everybody go hunting right at the start of the game. But just so you know, remember, I used the hut on my turn, so I actually have six people to feed, and I didn't go on the harvest track. So I have to pay six. They just go back into the supply.
Yep, whenever anything is paid, it goes back to the supply.
And Jeb didn't go to the hut, but he did go here, so he actually got, like, he's not going to spend as much money. He would spend he would probably just have taken his five spot, put it back here, and kept that one. Whatever. My point is that he had to spend five. I had to spend six on mine. Now, here's
the
bad part. If you cannot feed your tribe, or you choose not to feed your tribe because you don't have enough, and it's an all or nothing thing, I believe. You have to feed everybody. It's not like, I can feed four, not close enough. You either feed everybody or you don't. If you don't, you immediately lose 10 victory points. Yes, you heard me right, 10 victory points. And then you just go backwards on the scoring track. However, and I don't remember because Jeb's going to he's looking at the cues. I don't remember exactly what the exchange is. You can exchange resources for food. How does that work, Jeff?
If you don't have enough food, you can exchange one resource for one food.
Okay,
so it's you're paying
pretty, if especially like
if you have six gold and you have no food and six people, you're spending six gold to not lose 10 points. And
right. So it's kind of a trade-off. You need to think if it's worth it or not.
And one thing about that is you can only do that after you use all your food.
Right. So you still get rid of all your food. The question is, what's the trade-off? Like, if I had to give up a piece of wood,
That's not that bad.
If I had to give up a piece of gold, I might suffer the consequences because I figure the gold's going to let me buy, next turn I can buy a 16-point victory thing.
Right.
All right, well, I'll still be at plus six if I do that. So you have to think about if it's worth it or not. But the penalty for not feeding the tribe is relatively substantial at 10, and that would happen every time you can't feed them. So because you're not a very good leader if you're not feeding your people.
And I actually don't know about negative numbers.
It does say you can go into the negative. I guess you would have to, or at least I believe it does, that you can...
I would assume you just you move your cube back and put it to the side of the board or whatever to indicate that. But anyway, after you pay the food, and everybody pays the food, you're going to pass the first player token clockwise. So the new first player is made. And then at the beginning of the new round, you are going to slide the civilization cards to the right and add any new ones. So these would come over and then flip a new one. So that would be filled. And then you need to readjust the tool tiles.
That means if you tilted them, you get now is where you reset.
Oh, okay. All right.
That means reset in their language. Okay. And I did just double check on. Yes, you can go negative. It says player may end up with a negative score. It's literally what it says. It doesn't say they stop at zero. So I guess you'd have to get a piece of paper or something. And
I would just say,
if you're going that much negative, yeah. I don't know what you're doing. You're probably just being goofy at that point. But anyways.
Yeah, so at the new round, you replace the civilization cards, and any of these that were
used
turned,
are now ready to go again.
And then you just repeat the rounds over and over until the game in condition happens, which we already mentioned. Having enough civilization cards to fill the four,
right.
Or running out of one of the building piles.
Right.
And then final scoring, you will follow the points on the summary sheet. You do whatever it says to add the scores to your score track, and the winner is the person with the most. If there is a tie, you compare the agricultural level, and then the tool value, and then the number of meeples, figures, whatever. So there are some tiebreakers.
So everything, I think, Jeb, is pretty straightforward in this game, except for the civilization cards and the building cards do happen to have a lot of symbols, but there's a nice little sheet in the game that tells you exactly what everything does, and a lot of the stuff you don't have to worry about until end game anyways, so they do a really good job of telling you what all the cards do. So it's pretty good that way.
Yeah. And then the one other thing to note are there are game changes for two or three players.
Okay.
So one big thing, which in the rule book at the very end, there's a section for it, but I don't believe it mentions this one. The number of, what are they, huts?
Buildings?
Yeah. The number of stacks is equal to the number of players.
Right, we said that earlier.
Yeah, just so, re-emphasizing.
But that. If we went down to three, just out of the game. Because honestly, if you kept everything in, that win condition would take a really long time.
Yeah.
I mean, it could. You could prolong the game longer than it really needs to go.
Yeah, and then in the section, it has limitations on how many players can place on certain locations. I'm not going to go into that.
So it wouldn't be a full seven in like the whatever it is.
It's like only like two players can place on the forest or something like that.
Yeah.
But
they scale these spots if you have less than, because the point of the game was like hopefully sometimes stuff is full so you have to readjust.
Right.
Or, you know, everybody would just go wild. Yeah. And to me that makes a worker placement better.
Mm-hmm. You gotta fight for
yeah,
stuff.
When you gotta when you really need to make good decisions. So that's really it for mechanics. We probably even talked longer than we needed to. So
yeah.
we just wanted to make sure we were thorough. That's about it. We'll be back for a four-player game in just a second.